So I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to give these talks. It's a great honor to speak here. And so I want to talk about something that I call perfectoid spaces. And let me first give a sort of some general introduction to what perfectoid spaces are. So the general aim is somehow to get a comparison between objects, a mixed characteristic 0p with objects in equal characteristic p. And somehow the basic theorem somehow is, so the idea is to get somehow a geometric and nice version of the theorem of Winter, Fontaine and Winter and Berger, which says that the absolute Galois groups, of QP, to which U, for example, there are many other choices, you adjoin all P power roots of P, so a mixed characteristic field, and of the Laurent series field over FP are isomorphic, and in some sense even canonically isomorphic. And so one sees somehow that after adjoining lots of P power roots to a mixed characteristic thing, you get something that in some ways looks like an equal characteristic thing. And so we generalize this to the following. So we want to have some kind of geometric objects over this mixed characteristic field and some kind of geometric objects over this equal characteristic field and compare them. And so let me just, as notation, put K this field and K flat this field, well, some slight variations of this, so some. And then it becomes true that a certain category of so-called perfectoid spaces over K is canonically equivalent to the category of the same kind of spaces over this equal characteristic field. So I denote the functor by X maps to X flat. And so let me state some general properties of this equivalence. To give you some idea of what's going on. So first of all, perfectoid spaces are locally ringed topological spaces. And so in particular, one can talk about the underlying topological space. And in fact, that's just the same on both sides. And even better, not only the topological spaces are the same, but even the etal topoi are canonically equivalent. So somehow, if you just take X to be the point spec K or something, then this will exactly reprove somehow the theorem of Fontaine, Winter, and Berger. In fact, we will need this as an ingredient, but somehow this serves as a generalization somehow to the relative setting of the theorem of Fontaine and Winter, and Berger. Another property is that this isomorphism there between the categories is somehow of a deeply analytic nature. So in some sense, there are some limit procedures involved in this isomorphism. And so we have to leave the world of algebraic geometry. And instead, we have to use some language of rigid analytic geometry. geometry. And there's a reason that they are called perfectoid, namely the objects are perfect in a certain sense. So meaning that if we are in characteristic P, in equal characteristic P, then all the rings that occur are perfect. And in mixed characteristic, we have a similar condition. So guaranteeing somehow that there are lots of p power roots. So one thing that we see from this is already that the rings are that we will deal with are highly non-Noetherian. So perfect rings are basically never Noetherian. And so maybe technically not so easy, but okay. And I want to add some words about how perfectoid spaces are related to varieties. So for example, in characteristic P, we have a functor from varieties over K to perfectoid spaces over K. So, over K flat then. And so let's denote this by X maps to X perf. And in fact, it's clear that this functor factors over the category of rigid analytic varieties. So, varieties over K flat. So, X mapping to X rig, which then maps to X perf. So somehow first you associate the identification to X and then you make the structure sheaf perfect, basically. And so these two are sufficiently close to another. For example, it's true that the etal topos of this associated perfectoid space is just the same as the etal topos of the associated rigid analytic variety. And in particular, the etal cohomology of the two objects will agree. But there's no such functor in characteristic zero. So somehow in characteristic zero, there's no canonical way to adjoin p power roots in general. Nonetheless, there are some favorable situations where one can still give nice constructions of perfectoid spaces also in characteristic zero. So let me give some examples of perfectoid spaces in characteristic zero. Which also somehow gives a flavor of what such a space looks like. So one thing one could do is one takes the A1 over K and say takes the associated rigid analytic variety. Or I will take some slightly different thing, but think of it as the rigid analytic variety. And then takes the inverse limit over the piece power map where T is the coordinate on A1. So of course for A1 there's some canonical way to adjoin lots of p power roots. And that's what we do. So more generally, for any toric variety, we can do the same. We can take the inverse limit over the map phi, which is on monoids given by multiplication by p, of the rigid analytic variety associated to k. And then, in this, say, first example, one can even describe the tilt. So, I didn't say this. So this isomorphism between the equal and mixed characteristic series is what I call tilting. So in this case, the tilt of this inverse limit is just the same thing constructed in characteristic P. But there are some other cases where one more or less has a canonical way to adjoin something like p-power roots and say A over K is a Abelian variety. Then you can look at the inverse limit over multiplication by P of the associated Wittgen analytic variety. And again, this is a perfectoid space. And at least if A has ordinary reduction, one can describe tilt again as the inverse limit over multiplication by P over some other variety A prime over this other field, where A prime over K flat. You can describe it via Sayre-Tate canonical parameters. Described via Sayre-Tate canonical parameters. Okay? And there are even more examples. So you can take over the ring of integers in K, you can take some P-divisible group. Somehow, from here on, it's all in progress. And I haven't checked in which generality exactly I can say which things. But for ordinary reduction, somehow, it's the easiest. For good ordinary reduction, yes. Yeah, sorry, yeah. So if X is a P-divisible group, then one can again take its generic fiber, where say it's a formal P-divisible group, so it's supposed to be something like the open unit ball. And then again, you can take the inverse limit over multiplication by P. And then this is also related to some so-called Banach-Kolmez spaces occurring in Pierre de Koch theory. And also the moduli spaces, some of Abelian varieties or P-divisible groups, have this nice property. So if you have a Shimura variety, depending on a level, so then you can take the inverse limit over all levels at P of the corresponding rigid analytic variety. Or you can take xk, k running through compact open subgroups of some group G of QP, a Rappaport Singh space. And can look at the inverse limit over k of xk. So this means that in this, I mean, it's been a problem for a long time if you have, say, the Blumen-Tate tower, that you would like to look at it at the infinite level. And now it turns out that at the infinite level, this clearly becomes a space, namely a perfectoid space. And so, for example, one sees that one can take the inverse limit of the Drinfeld tower. And this really now is canonically isomorphic as a perfectoid space to the inverse limit of the Lumen-Tate tower. So there's also Jared Weinstein working on this now. So as perfectoid spaces. Okay? So. This is some of the general introduction. So these perfectoid spaces are really some rigid analytic spaces, but of an infinite type. So they're not Noetherian, not anything. And in particular, for example, I don't think that one can describe perfectoid spaces as a category of certain formal models, modulo some sort of admissible blow-ups, because these flattening techniques seem to require the Noetherian hypotheses. So we have to look for some other approach to rigid analytic geometry, and the one that I choose is a Huber theory of eddic spaces. And in this first lecture, I will basically now explain what an eddic space is and compare the theory to other existing theories in rigid analytic geometry. So throughout, let me fix. So the definition is the following. A non-Archimedean field K is a topological field whose topology is induced by a non-trivial valuation of rank 1. So throughout, let me fix a non-Archimedean field K. And there's an essentially unique norm map from K to the positive reals. And let us fix one, which is not really necessary for Huber's theory, but for comparing them with other theories, it may be helpful. Okay, so some basic idea of rigid analytic geometry is somehow, it should be an analog of the theory of complex analytic spaces over C, and so there should be a functor, or eddic spaces now, there should be a functor from the varieties over this field K to now the category of eddic spaces over K, sending X to X art. And somehow on this eddic space, it should now make sense to talk about the subspace where a function is somehow bounded by one or something. So, and sort of the following should make sense somehow for all functions on your space. Something like this should make sense. So in particular, one basically sees that any point has to give rise to some sort of valuation map. So okay. So there are now three approaches which have this requirement. So some of this approach of rigid analytic geometry. You take X rig, which is a set of closed points of X. So somehow, if X is a closed point, then somehow there is a, and say this is just affine, then we get, so this corresponds to some, X corresponds to some so a maximal ideal. So we get a map to R mod M, which is some finite field extension of K. And the norm on K extends to any finite extension, so we get a natural map to the positive reals, and this gives a variation corresponding to this closed point. Yes, I wanted to say this, but I forgot. Yeah, I assume throughout that all my rings are complete. Somehow the whole theory will not change when one replaces a ring by its completion. So I take the freedom to assume that they are complete. Okay. Then there's Berkovich theory, where one considers certain norm maps from your ring R to the positive reals. So extending the variation which you already have on K. So this gives you more points, and I will later in an example describe these points. But there is something still more general that one can do. One allows basically all possibly higher rank valuations. Right, I will explain the comparison to other theories later. But again, in the situation that I will, of perfectoid spaces, I don't know whether these comparisons still work. So let me start by defining what Huber calls a valuation. So let R be some ring. Then a valuation on R is a map Huber writes, this should usually be called a norm, but I stick with Huber's terminology of calling it a valuation. So it's a map from R to gamma union zero, where gamma is some totally ordered abelian group. So for example, it could be the positive reals. And satisfying the following requirements. So the value of 0 is 0, the value of 1 is 1. The value of x plus y is at most the maximum of the values of x and y. And so this is, and it's multiplicative, so the absolute value of x times y. So somehow I think he calls it valuation because one is used to talking about higher rank valuations, but one is not used to talk about higher rank norms somehow. But okay. So, and now if R is a topological ring, as it will be in the cases that we are interested in, then this map is called continuous. For all gamma and gamma, the set of all x and r such that the absolute value is less than gamma, this is open. Right, gamma is not necessarily the value group, but I will now define a notion of equivalence which somehow does not see the value group. So, so in this context, let me make several definitions. So we have let gamma, absolute value, subset of gamma, be the subgroup generated by all absolute value of x, x and r, such that they are not zero. And what else do I need? An absolute value has its support, which is a the set of all x and r which have absolute value zero. This is in prime ideal. And the last thing I need is that somehow any valuation factors as you first project to the quotient by the support. And then you can even take, as this is now integral, the quotient field of this. And then there's a norm now to gamma union zero from there. And let me call this k. Then the norm gives some rise to this residue field k. But it additionally gives rise to a valuation subring of k, which is a set of all x and k, such that the absolute value is at most one. So this subset of k is a valuation subring. And now we say that two valuations, norm and norm prime, are equivalent if the following equivalent conditions are satisfied. Following equivalent conditions satisfied. So one way to say it is that there is an isomorphism between these subgroups such that the obvious diagram commutes. So we have R mapping to this is an But there are other ways of saying the same thing. So it's also equivalent to saying that the support is the same. And the valuation, the ranks that they define are the same, which then, of course, live in the same quotient field. And third condition is that the absolute value for A and B and R, the absolute value of A is bigger than B, and only if the same is true for the other valuation. Okay, so and some of the topological spaces that will underlie these locally ringed topological spaces are now certain equivalence classes of continuous valuations on these rings. And Huber defines such spaces in very great generality, but we will not need this utmost generality, and I will specialize somewhat to the case that is of interest to us now. So that's what he calls the Tate K algebra. This is a topological K algebra R. And one has to put some assumption on how this topology looks like. And the following assumption put by Huber, so he assumes that there exists an subring R not in R such that A times R not with A an invertible element of K, such that this forms a basis of open neighborhoods of zero. So for example, you can take R, the ring of convergent power series in several variables. So meaning the set of those sums, A, I1 up to I, so A, G to the I, I bigger than 0, using multi-index notation such that the coefficients go to 0. And then you can take are not inside it just as the subring of those power series with integral coefficients. And I forgot to introduce that K not is a set of all elements which have absolute value at most one. No. And second is that an affinoid K algebra is a pair. So somehow spaces in Huber's setup are not associated to a single ring but to a pair of rings. And so this is a pair RR plus where R is Tate. And R plus in subset of R upper not, which is defined to be the set of power bounded elements. In R is an open and integrally closed subring. But in fact, in all cases of relevance in rigid analytic geometry, it will be just the ring of power bonded elements. So it's not of great importance. And the last part is that what do I say? Ah, such a thing is called is of topologically finite type. So I just write T F T. If R is a quotient of such a thing for some n, so that's just the kind of algebras that appear in classical rigid analytic geometry, and also R plus is really just R naught. And again, one need not put the assumption that R is complete, but it does not change the theory if one does. So we assume from now on that R plus is complete. Okay, and now we can define the topological space associated to such a thing. So be a finite K-algebra.
Excuse me, in the definition here, this implies that R plus is equal to R naught?
No. It does not imply. It's a condition. I've put this condition. So somehow there is a general definition of what a topologically finite type algebra is, and in this case, somehow it boils down to this condition. Finite K algebra. Okay, so then we define space called the Eddick spectrum of R R plus, and it's defined to be the set of all continuous variations with the property that on these integral elements they are at most one. And you take these up to equivalence. Okay, so this is some set. And we want to endow it with a topology. And the topology can be defined in the following way. So first, for any x and x, we write f maps to the absolute value of f at x for the corresponding valuation. Corresponding valuation. And so the topology is spaces of open neighborhoods given by the rational subsets and they are defined as an open subset depending on certain functions f1, fn, and g, and it's a set of all those x and x such that for all I the absolute value of fi of x is at most the absolute value of g of x, where The Fs are certain elements of R that generate R. And G is just any element of R. So one, if one is used to Berkovich's series, then one might wonder that one puts a non-strict inequality here, and this is supposed to define an open subset. But I will give a justification for using a non-strict inequality here later. So, okay. And in fact, it turns out that this topological space is somehow very scheme-like in a sense.
What sense do they generate R?
It's an ideal, yes. Sorry.
But don't you need also the case where F, the Fs and G generate R? For example,
well, you can just always add the G to the Fs because this condition for G is always satisfied. Okay, so this is a somewhat scheme-like topological space. So it really feels like doing algebraic geometry if one is working with them. And for this, let me recall the following definition. A topological space X is called spectral. If the following equivalent conditions are satisfied, the first is that X is topologically isomorphic to the spectrum of some ring. Okay, so it is very scheme-like. The second condition is something which does not somehow use this strange definition. It can be written as an inverse limit of finite notch spaces. That's still maybe not very concrete. And there's another way of saying it is that X is quasi-compact. I will just write QC. And has a basis of quasi-compact open subsets, basis for topology. Of quasi-compact open subsets, which is stable under intersections. And every irreducible subset has a unique generic point. Every irreducible closed subset. Has unique generic point. So, and for example, one can take the rational subsets in definition 3. Okay. Well, somehow there is a paper where this equivalence is proved, and this paper proceeds in the following way. First of all, for any finite knot space, it constructs some example, and it does so in a functorial way. And then you can just pass to the inverse limit. But I just don't think there is any relevance of this ring. But
okay, I guess your example of this, your construction.
Well, there's no ring, no. But somehow, this implies that X is in particular quasi-compact, quasi-separated, meaning that the intersection of two quasi-compact opens is again quasi-compact open. It's again quasi-compact. And it's T0, so it has some nice properties, some of which will be used later. And in particular, there's also a good theory of constructible subsets somehow of this topological space. Okay. So moreover, somehow this space is somehow not empty. I mean, it could be that there are no variations at all, and then it would not be very interesting. But so it is large in some ways. So for example, if X is zero, then R is already the zero ring. Secondly, if F is an element such that the absolute value of F of X is non-zero for all X and X, then F is invertible. And certainly, if F is an R such that its absolute value is at most one everywhere, then F is in the subring of positive elements. Okay. And okay, now we have associated to some such affinity K-algebra some topological space, and now we want to endow it with some structure sheaf. And so now we want to define the structure sheaf. And the definition is as follows. So it's somehow enough to define the structure sheaf on rational subsets. So and let us choose R naught and R as above. So somehow, such that it somehow defines the topology on R. And then we consider the following algebra. So both of these are some subalgebras of R where you invert G. And we equip it with a topology making basis of neighborhoods of zero. And then we let OX of U, OX plus of U be the completion. And one may wonder about the notation, as the definition obviously involves some choices. But we have the following. proposition is that, first off, this is a, as defined, it's a an affine K algebra again. And secondly, it has the following universal property. For any complete, I mean, I've always assumed complete, but here it really becomes important. For any complete affinoid K algebra SS plus with map from RR plus to SS plus, such that the corresponding map on spaces factors over U then there exists a unique map from OX of U, OX plus of U to SS plus, somehow making the obvious diagram commute. And hence, it really does only depend on U. No, I don't yet, but it is true.
But then you have to state that to, if you say hence, then you still need something. I mean, otherwise, this property will be too weak, as stated, to uniquely characterize. Because maybe, because you consider those things with factors for you, so you can just have a bigger one. And what works for a bigger one will. No.
No. I mean, this universal property in the statement only involves the subset U and nothing else.
No, but it doesn't characterize uniquely. There seems to be something missing to say that this universal property is really characterized uniquely. And because you did not say that this is an example of something where this factorizes through U.
Ah, yeah, you're probably right, yeah. And, sorry. Okay. And so, and now for any U and X open, define OX of U to be the inverse limit over all W contained in U which are rational of OX of W. And same for OX plus. And then there is a basic problem that it's not in general known. It's not in general known that this OX is actually a sheaf. So this is only a pre-sheaf here. But there is a following theorem of Huber I mean, and it probably should not be true in general. But there's a following theorem saying that if any such ring of convergent power series on an open on a ball somewhere over your R is an Noetherian for all n, then OX is a sheaf. So some of the basic problem, so this is satisfied if R is of topologically finite type. So the basic problem is somehow that completion is not so well behaved when you're in a non-Noetherian situation. And later we will somehow we'll be trying to associate spaces to such so-called perfectoid algebras, which do not satisfy this theorem, but we will still be able to prove that this OX is a sheaf. Topologically ring valued sheaf. So somehow the maps are strict also, some of that appear. In which rings?
Let's say R of T.
I'm not sure.
If
it's topologically finite type, then it's of course just the usual case, so ideals are closed. Yeah. Okay.
So Noetherian, that means algebraic.
Yes. Okay, let me say a few words before making a short break. So, about these pre-sheafs OX and OX plus in general. So, we're back in the summer. Even if OX is not a sheaf, the following stays true for any X and X. The variation extends to OXX, the local ring, and OXX plus is a set of those Fs in OXX with absolute value at most one. So it's a variation subring. No. Somehow then you have the residue field. K of X of this local ring, and you have the image of OXX plus plus, and then this is a variation subring, of course. So somehow at each point of this adic space you get a residue field, and in this residue field you also get a corresponding variation subring. And in fact it's true that for all U and X open, this sheaf OX plus can be reconstructed from OX somehow by saying that it's those functions such that for all X and U, the absolute value is at most one. And so in particular, before any X, we get some OX, a certain pre-sheaf OX, and certain maps, the absolute value at X for any X in X. So certain triple. And then the definition is that if OX is a sheaf, then this is called an affinoid adic space. And okay, let me make a break here for say 15 minutes. Let me continue. So what we have done up till now is we have started with some kind of topological algebras, and we have associated some kind of locally ringed spaces to them, and now we want to glue them. And for this, we consider the category of triples as above. So we have some topological space X, some OX, and some variations for any X and X. So where XOX is a locally ringed topological space. But in fact, OX is a sheaf of topological algebras. And F maps to absolute value of F at X is a variation on the local ring. And it's even continuous variation. And they form a category in a natural way, and then we define an adic space is such a triple that is locally on X affinoid. Is such a triple okay. So finally, we have defined what an adic space is, and so somehow one has a category of such complete, let me stress this, affinoid K algebras. And in there, one has the ones where OX is a sheaf. These now are now equivalent to the affinoid adic spaces. Over K. And of course, there is then a subcategory of the category of adic spaces over K. OK. And now let me draw a picture in a simple example. So we take the ring R to be just convergent power series on the disk in one variable. And as the integral subring, really just the power series with integral coefficients. And then the picture looks as follows. We have some points, then we have some point here, then we have lots of arcs, as in the Berkovich picture somehow. And then it can also end somewhere in the middle. And around this point, let me zoom in. So we have this point, and we have some arcs going out. And additionally, we have one point here for each arc going out of this thing. And the same thing happens somehow at each other branching point. So let me enumerate all of these points. So I take the same enumeration as Berkovich uses, except that there will be some additional ones at the end. So first of all, so I assume that K is complete and algebraically closed for simplicity. So first, we can take a point of absolute value at most 1. Then we have the map that sends a power series to the evaluation at x, which is then some element in k bar. And then you can compose with the norm. Okay, so these are some of the points which I draw on the outside here. So then there are the points of type 2, which is some, for example, such a branching point or anything else which lies on this ray. So let me do both of them together. So again, you fix some point in K bar of absolute value at most 1. But additionally, you choose some real number between 0 and 1. And then you can produce what is often called a Gauss norm. So you send a power series, which now you rewrite centered around centered around x, and you send this to the supremum of the absolute value of a n times r to the n. So, and it turns out that this can also be written as a supremum over all y, such that the absolute value, the distance to x is at most r of the absolute value of f at y. So somehow here f gets mapped to the absolute value of f at x. So in particular, this depends only on the disk around x of radius r. So this means that for any disk inside this picture, we get a new point. And somehow any point x is connected with a ray, which is the interval of length 1 to one point, which is somehow the same for all points, because this disk of radius 1 will always be the same. And somehow for any point, you get such a branch which goes from this point to there, but they start to merge at some points, depending on the distance. Then there are some rather strange points. If you have a decreasing sequence of disks, such that the intersection of all the I is empty, such things can exist, for example, for CP. And then we get a point f maps to the infimum over all I of the supremum over all x and di of the absolute value of f at x. So somehow going the other way, somehow from the interior now to the outside, it may happen that somehow you get stuck in the middle here somewhere. But the most interesting points now are those which they have type 5, which are the ones that are around this point there, for example. And say we get them in the following way. We take the following totally ordered abelian group. We take the positive reals, but we introduce a second factor, which I call gamma to the z. So as a group, it's just a copy of the integers. And would require that this new variable gamma lies strictly between any real number less than 1 and 1. So for then we can send such a power series to the maximum of absolute value of a n times gamma to the n. And again, this defines a point. And somehow this is sort of the same sort as in 2 or 3, but except that we are now taking this parameter r infinitesimally close to 1. So this means that somehow on this line here, it lies infinitesimally close to this point here. So that's what I wanted to draw here. And so we have a similar picture around any point of type 2. Ah. So I should say what type 2 means. Two corresponds to the case that r is in the value group of k, and case 3 corresponds to the case that this is not the case. And then one easily checks that somehow a branching occurs at some point on such array if and only if it's of type 2. And at such branching points, one gets for any ray going out, one gets an additional point of type 5. Okay, so it seems that there are lots of points, and maybe one has no clue of what they are good for. But I will give now several other ways in which this topological space naturally appears. somewhere in nature. So first, let me give the theorem that compares rigid analytic varieties to eddic spaces, and it's the following. So there is a fully faithful functor. From the category of rigid analytic varieties over K to the category of eddic spaces over K. So X maps to X ed. And it maps the rigid analytic variety associated to some usual Tate algebra to this eddic thing. So for any R not of topologically finite type. Okay. And one may wonder what the image is, and of course one has to put a finiteness assumption on those eddic spaces. So one would expect that the image of this should be exactly in the eddic spaces locally of finite type over K. So meaning that it's locally spar R are not, where R are not is topologically finite type. That this should be some of the image. And obviously the image is contained in it, but in general there are some strange ways to glue eddic spaces which are not present in the rigid analytic world. But as soon as you assume that your space is quasi-separated, you get an equivalence. So but basically everything is quasi-separated, so it's not such a huge restriction. And so now let X be a quasi-separated rigid analytic variety. Then the following nice statements are true. So rigid analytic varieties carry a natural Grothendieck topology of so-called admissible covers and admissible open subsets. So, and the nice thing about eddic spaces is that you get a very convenient reinterpretation of what an admissible open is. It turns out that a set of quasi-admissible opens in X is just the same as the set of all quasi-compact opens in the associated eddic space, sending any u somewhere to the intersection of u with x. And the converse functor I denote by u maps to u tilde. So recall that somehow any classical point gives you an eddic point. So in this way, you can consider the classical points as a subset of the eddic space. And so this intersection makes sense. And what's even better is that certain ui and x cover from an admissible cover if and only if certain the associated subsets of x of the eddic space cover x ed just in the usual sense. So in other words, this language of admissible opens and admissible coverings is just reinterpreted just as opens and covers in the eddic world. So very nice. And so it follows that sheaves over the Grothendieck topos of X are just the same as achieves over the underlying topological space of the Eddick space. And in fact, this already determines X Ed uniquely if we make a slight technical assumption that it should be sober. So there is somehow out of the theory of admissible subsets, it's even possible to directly cook up this Eddick space. And let me also give an example of how you see this non-admissibility in the example above. So a typical example of a non-admissible cover would be to cover somehow this disk which we consider, so basically the subset of all x, which have absolute value at most one. So you can cover this by the set of all x which have absolute value one, or plus a union over all reals less than one of the set where the absolute values at most are. But this should not form an admissible cover because left hand side should be connected. And so what happens in this picture here is that somehow the subset where it's the absolute value is equal to one is somehow this thing. And then the other thing gives you increasing balls here. And if you look at this now at this point, then you will get larger and larger subsets here. You will get this subset. But this one point is not in there. Precisely because the absolute value of x, which is this gamma, is strictly between 1 and 0 for all r less than 1. Okay. It's also the total what?
What is the topology finally on the?
Well, somehow, I mean, it's generated by these rational subsets. But for example, if you look at this subset here, then this is topologically the same as the spectrum of the A1 over the residue field kappa. So kappa is the residue field of K. So meaning that this is somehow a generic point, and it specializes to all the other points, which are somehow form the closed points of an affine line. And so for example, if you just take out this one point, this will somehow be open at that part. And okay. And there is a second way to construct this underlying topological space of an Eddick space, which is to use the following theorem of Renault. That if you are only interested in quasi-compact and quasi-separated rigid analytic varieties okay, then each of them admits a formal model, saying a quasi-compact admissible formal scheme. Over some of the ring of integers, which is K0. but of course, such a formal model is not unique, and any two somehow you have to localize by the category of admissible blow-ups, meaning blow-ups that only change the special fiber in a sense. So let me denote this functor by x maps to x rig. And using the equivalence for rigid analytic varieties, that's all the same as a quasi-compact eddic space locally of or finite type over K. So it gives you also an eddic space. And then there exists a continuous specialization map from the underlying topological space of the eddic space to X. And so it's continuous, not anti-continuous as in Berkovich's setting. And if you take X, any given quasi-compact, quasi-separated eddic space, locally of finite type, over K, then it admits formal models. And so the following does make sense. You can look at the inverse limit over all formal models of the underlying space of X. So these specialization maps give you a map to this inverse limit, and it turns out that this is just an homeomorphism. So how does this look like in the example? So you can, one formal model would be just to take the spiff of this thing, and then the special fiber is just the A1 over the residue field. And how does the specialization map look like? So you have this generic point, and then this strange point around, and then some other bunch of stuff. And this just maps to the A1 over K, which is again this point, by contracting all rays. Okay. And hence, you see that such a subset, for example, should be closed. And if you think about it, then this precisely tells you that you should put non-strict inequalities to define open subsets and strict inequalities to define closed subsets. And also, somehow, what happens in this procedure, somehow you have one formal model, which is the A1. And then you're allowed to do some blow-ups. And so this introduces some P1 here, and then some additional P1, and so on. And so this builds up the tree somehow. And they introduce many more P1s. And somehow, the strict transform of any such P1 somehow survives up to the inverse limit. And it gives you precisely somehow these P1s which you have around any such point of type 2. So some of the points of type 2 are precisely the ones that specialize to a generic point in some subformal model, and then some get always mapped to this generic point. And yes, okay.
So you can just see that this is the dual graph of what appears here.
Why the dual graph? There's no dual things. I mean, yeah, but But I mean, you can really topologically say what happens without sort of talking about dual stuff and so on. So. And somehow, yeah, somehow the EDIC language is compatible with the formal models in a very nice way. For example, this specialization map is continuous. But even more, Huber defines EDIC spaces in a much more general setup, which also include formal models for rigid spaces. And so, and then passing to the generic fiber, as in the sense of Renault, really is passing to the generic fiber somehow. So. Okay. And so finally, I want to say a few words about the comparison with Berkovich spaces. And for this, I need the following definition. An EDIC space X is called taut. T-H-U-T. T-A-U-T. If it's quasi-separated, and for any quasi-compact open U and X, also the closure is quasi-compact. So that's some technical condition, but it turned out that, I mean, most spaces that you will encounter in nature are taut, but there are now some examples which occur in nature where you have really non-taut EDIC spaces. And then we have the following theorem. Is that there is an equivalence of categories. Between the category of Hausdorff, strictly K-analytic Berkovich spaces, with the category of taut, rigid analytic taut, yeah. Rigid analytic varieties, for example, over K, or then what is some of the same as taut EDIC spaces locally of finite type. Finite type over K. So sending somehow a Berkovich space, let me denote it by X Berk, to the EDIC space. So, okay, and then there is a tautological map from the underlying topological space of the Berkovich space to the EDIC space, but this is not continuous. So somehow the image is just the subset of rank one valuations. But there is a better map, so there's a retraction. From the EDIC space to the Berkovich space. Which identifies the Berkovich space with a maximal Hausdorff quotient of X. So continuous, no. Identifying maximal Hausdorff quotient of x art. And so, how does this look like in the example? Okay, so let me draw it again. So you have this, in the attic world, you have some of this and then the whole tree. And again, some strange points here. And the Berkovich looks basically the same, except that it doesn't have these strange points. So you just have some this tree. Nice that it is. And okay. And so this contracts any point of type 2 with all points of type 5 around. Okay. So I mean, and it has to somehow because this Berkovich space is Hausdorff, and some of these points of type 5 lie in the topological closure of this point. So any map to a Hausdorff topological space has to contract them, and that's precisely what it does. So in a sense, one can somehow reconstruct this Berkovich space from the attic space. Okay, and so the last thing for today is to explain somehow the fibers of this map to the Berkovich space, more or less. So or in other words, giving a different interpretation to the points of an attic space. And for this, let me assume that X is a finite. And in fact, we can go back to the complete generality, not even assuming that X is a sheaf for now. So. Necessarily a sheaf. Okay, so for any point x and x, we have associated somehow a pair consisting of the residue field of x and a evaluation subring. And this gives rise to the following definition, that an affinoid field, so some in classical algebraic geometry points are more or less maps to fields, and so in the attic geometry, a point will more or less be a map to an affinoid field. So an affinoid field is a pair k, k plus, where K is a non-Archimedean field, and and K plus and K is an open valuation subring. And again, we will often only work in the complete case, but these are not in general complete, so somehow.
You allow the world of K as an open valuation subring?
No, I mean, yeah, I should say the power bound elements. Okay? So, and then we have the following proposition. Let R R plus be an affine K algebra. And then the points of this Lx space are in bijection with maps R R plus to K K plus, where so where KK plus is an affinoid field, complete affinoid field, and I mean you can always make some of the field larger, and to exclude this case, we sort of assume that. The quotient field of the image of R and K is dense. And so somehow, in Berkowitz's theory, a point is simply given by a map to a complete non-Archimedean field. And here we sort of additionally have to remember this valuation subring in there. And so somehow, the fibers of this map to the Berkowitz space are precisely somehow parameterized by the valuation subrings inside of this corresponding non-Archimedean field. And using this description of points, it's also easy to say when one point specializes to another point in this Lx space. So let me recall the definition of specialization of points. Say X specializes to Y, which is written X somewhat greater than Y. If Y is in the topological closure of X, and then we have the following proposition that if X, Y are in the Lx spectrum of R, R plus, then corresponding somehow to maps K, K plus, or K prime, K prime plus, then X specializes to Y if and only if, first of all, they give rise to the same non-Archimedean field. So somehow, if you have such an isomorphism here, commuting with the maps from R, and somehow the valuation subring corresponding to X is more general in the sense, which means that it's larger. So this way. And so we see that in particular, any non-Archimedean field admits the set of power bounded elements in K as a valuation subring. And And this is the one that corresponds to the unique rank one valuation. Unique rank one valuation. And one sees that somehow, for any case, there's a unique generic point. So which specializes to any other point for the same x, for the same field k. And for any x and x corresponding to a rank n valuation, the set of all y such that y specializes to x. Well, it's the wrong way, but okay. And so this forms a chain of lengths precisely n. So in the example somehow there was this generic point and the special points around it. This one was a rank one valuation, and there's only one point above it, namely itself. So the chain is of length one, and for the other point somehow there's precisely this one point which specializes to it, and you get a chain of length two, which is also the rank of this valuation. And so that's somehow more or less a general picture about adic spaces, and that's it for today.